April 9th, 1940. The Nazi invasion of Norway has begun. Vast amounts of German troops and armored forces trample across the neutral country of Norway, seeking to extract the raw materials that the land possesses. However, there's one resource that's more powerful than any amount of oil, coal, or iron that the Germans could use: heavy water. And while the Allies know the power that this material has, and the dangers if Germany possesses it, the Allies will rely on a handful of trained Norwegian saboteurs to take a stand against the Germans to stop them from producing an atomic weapon before it can be unleashed. With the German invasion of Poland on September 9, 1939, Nazi Germany swung the continent into a second world war. With their massive army and resources, the Nazis quickly conquered the nearby countries of Poland, Belgium, the Netherlands, and France. With the Nazis' further desires to expand into Africa and England, they had a greater demand for more resources. To accomplish this, one weapon could meet all of their demands and desires to conquer the world: the atomic bomb. In mid-September 1939, the Nazis' atomic program, the Uranium Club, headed by atomic physicist Kurt Dübner, met to discuss the harnessing of an atom's energy for the development of an atomic weapon. Werner Heisenberg, a leading German theoretical physicist who also won the Nobel Peace Prize, was led to believe that the substance called heavy water could be the moderator, a vital part of an atomic reaction. The moderator was a crucial part in creating nuclear fission, which can lead to an explosion of an atomic weapon. After the scientists confirmed that the heavy water would act as a successful moderator for nuclear fission, they then needed large amounts of the substance. However, the only producer in the world, Norsk Hydro, was located in the rugged deep canyons of Amork in Norway. In January of 1940, the Uranium Club's expansions on further tests led to the extensive orders of heavy water from the hydro plant. The company was asking for an explanation for the large amounts requested, but got nothing until a French negotiator named Jacques Allier told Norsk Hydro that the heavy water could be used for nuclear technology. Soon after, in April of 1940, the invasion of Norway began, and the Germans quickly housed the only producer of heavy water in the world and the potential supply for an atomic weapon. Once news of the Germans' plans reached London headquarters, they were shocked. The British were determined to destroy the facility by any means necessary if it meant preventing the usage of an atomic weapon. But the intel London received on the hydro plant wasn't detailed. They needed precise, first-hand accounts of what the Germans were doing in and around the Norsk Hydro facility in order to know how to attack the plant. Their information came from Leif Tronstad, a former professor and resistance fighter working at the British in Norway, who supplied intel about the Germans' movements before fleeing to Britain. Tronstad met up with Erik Welsh, the head of Norwegian branch of Special Intelligence Service in Britain, and together they designed a plan to stop the Germans' production of heavy water. Tronstad knew that bombing the facility would be doomed for failure, since the production room where the heavy water was housed was under 7 floors of concrete. So Tronstad and Welsh devised a plan to attack the facility with skilled and trained saboteurs by parachuting in. Under this plan, they organized a Special Operation Executive, or SOE, to train elite commandos to execute a given mission. The men for the job were Norwegian resistance fighters fleeing to Britain. Among them chosen were Jens Anton Poulsen, Arne Kjolstrup, Knut Haglund, and Claus Helberg. The men were trained to memorize the blueprints of the hydro plant and, with mock-ups, practice blowing up the distilling room where production of heavy water occurred. With their elite training, the team set off on their mission under the codename of Grouse on October 18, 1942. The Grouse team was parachuted in with Halifax bombers 50 miles west of Amork in the Hardangervidda, a mountainous plateau in central southern part of Norway. From there, the four-man team had to ski for 2 weeks with heavy supplies until they found a cabin 8 miles west of Amork. On November 9th, the Grouse team repaired their radio and were able to successfully contact London, setting up the second part of the raid, Operation Freshman. However, Operation Freshman would never reach the awaiting Grouse team. The two Horsa airspeed gliders that were planned to meet up with the Grouse team were thrown off course due to extreme weather conditions while being towed over the Vidda. The two gliders and one of the Halifax bombers towing them crashed 100 kilometers away from Amork, resulting in the death of 41 Allied troops on a one-way mission to attack the hydro facility. With the recent failure of the Freshman mission, along with not knowing how far the Nazis' atomic program was, SOE needed to counteract immediately. SOE turned to former Norwegian resistance fighter Joachim Rønneberg to lead an operation.
And then I was told that we were going to Vemork to blow up this heavy water factory. And we were also told about the trial which had been done already by British commandos with the two gliders. And we were told about the little group of Norwegians who had been back in Norway as a reception committee.
He was accompanied by five other resistance fighters. Among them chosen were Birger Strandsheim, Frederick Kaiser, Kasper Idlin, Hans Storag, and Knut Haglund. The men had no clue of the importance of heavy water, but realized that if they were going to be called in by SOE, then it must have been vital. The team was well trained by Britain's finest and had memorized blueprints of the facility as well as maps of the surrounding territory. The team's deployment was delayed due to harsh weather conditions and anti-aircraft fire over Norway, but were finally able to parachute into the Vidda, 25 miles north of Amark, on February 16th. The gunnerside team found their way to a nearby cabin and after 6 days of searching, located the awaiting Grouse team. The two teams united and the group quickly prepared to assault the hydro plant. Following the failed freshman mission, the Wehrmacht planted mines all around the facility and posted guards around the bridge leading to the plant to increase security. That left the saboteurs the lone route of climbing down and up the 600-foot ravine surrounding the hydro plant. The following night, on February 27, 1943, the United 9-man gunnerside team made their steep descent into the ravine. As the team made their weary climb out of the gorge, they made their way down the railway line that led to the hydro plant. At 12:30 a.m., the team successfully broke into the facility and made their way to the production room, where the 18 heavy water distilleries were located. The team quickly laid plastic explosives on each cell and lit a 30-second fuse to give them time to escape. As the gunnerside team retreated undetected along the railway line, a silent thud in the distance revealed the explosion in the production room. As searchlights and sirens blared, the gunnerside team were already making their way back to their cabin outpost, leaving the German atomic program in a tangled mess. The gunnerside team then had to make a 300-kilometer journey to Sweden, fleeing from the German forces that were patrolling the area. As news reached London of the success of the raid, they were astonished. Between 600 and 700 kilos of heavy water, or 4 months of production, had been destroyed in the assault. In addition to that, it would take the Germans another 6 months to rebuild and start production again, which led to the delay of almost 10 months in heavy water production. The delay of heavy water production forced the Germans to make the faulty decision of bringing the remaining stockpile of heavy water in Norway back to Germany in hopes of finishing an atomic weapon in late January of 1944. The remaining stockpile was transported on rail from the hydro facility and then on the DF hydro ferry across Lake Mael. Local SOE operatives, along with Skirland and Honklid, who had decided to stay in the Vidda after the gunnerside operations, scrambled to sabotage the remaining supply. On the 19th of February, they planted explosives and a timer on the DF Hydro that held the remaining stockpile of heavy water. On February 20th, 1944, at 10:45 a.m., the ferry was halfway across the lake when an explosion went off below deck. An 8.5-kilogram bomb ripped apart the hull of the DF Hydro, successfully sinking the remaining heavy water with the cost of 26 civilian lives. The effects of the heavy water sabotage carried out by the Norwegian and British forces were significant. The use of their combat and sabotaging skills in their three strategic raids resulted in the halting of the German atomic program and led to the tactical mishaps leading to the sinking of the Germans' last supply of heavy water on DF Hydro. The importance of the raids were stated by Leif Tronstad, the Norwegian's SOE leader.
"It can be used for one of the dirtiest things man can make. And if the Germans get it, we shall have lost the war, and London will be blown to pieces."
Without the bravery and actions accomplished by the saboteurs, the construction of a possible Nazi atomic weapon could have decided the outcome of the greatest world war. In mid-December of 1944, the Nazis' final offensive began with the Battle of the Bulge. The Nazis were desperate for raw materials to fuel their massive panzer armies. With a potential atomic weapon, the Nazis could have annihilated opposing Allied armies, giving them access to critical raw materials, leading to an increase of overwhelming casualties across Europe. However, with the halting of heavy water production, the Germans' hopes of ever producing an atomic weapon were crushed due to the heroic Norwegian saboteurs. They didn't realize the importance of heavy water, but still laid their lives on the line and took a stand against the opposing German regime.